Let's welcome Chemi Perez. Okay. Welcome.
Thank you. Wonderful to be here.
30 seconds about Chemi Perez. Chemi Perez is the general managing general partner and co-founder of Pitango, the largest Israeli VC firm. He serves as a board member in several non-for-profit organizations and as the chairman of the Paris Central Center for Peace and Innovation. He is the youngest son of Sony and President Shimon Peres, a Renaissance man, a visionary, a literature and a culture man who believes that the true change will come from economic, technological and environmental investment. We met last week and I'm very honored to share his stories with you. Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening.
So, I guess it's a long day.
It's a short day.
It's a short day. I'm just wondering what a day in your life looks like.
Every day is different. Days are full. Lots of varieties. I'm dealing with a lot of things, traveling around. So they keep me busy, and when I'm busy, I'm happy.
And traveling, you means in Israel, or you travel a lot also?
I travel a lot. Today I'm traveling all over the world. It's US, Asia Pacific, Europe, all over the world. And of course, I like also to travel from time to time for pleasure.
For pleasure, right.
Yeah. So Vietnam, Cambodia. My next one is Myanmar, Burma.
Okay. Anyone from Burma? Some tips?
Maybe we'll start a startup grind there.
Right. Maybe we have.
Maybe you have.
Maybe, let's see. I'm not sure. So you have a brother who is a veterinarian, a sister who works as a linguist at the university. You are all children of Sonia and President Shimon Peres, who is one of the most influential politicians in the history of Israel, for the ones who doesn't know. And yet, each one of you choose a very, very different career. Would it be correct to say that this is due to your mother's influence?
I would say that my parents never told us what to do. We lived by example. My father dedicated his life for Israel. And my mother was a very humble person. And I always say that as a venture capitalist, if I choose my companies just like I choose my parents, I would have been in heaven. But each one of us choose a different direction. Life has their own force, and each person has his or her own interests in life. They always encouraged us to live our lives, not to live somebody else's life.
I'm assuming, and I know some, but very little, we spent 1 hour together, that you have some very interesting stories from your childhood. Would it be okay if you could share with us a story or two? Just whatever story that will be.
Well, I recently had an interview. There's a big TV set that has been done about my father's life. And as part of it, they asked me to be interviewed. And they asked me to tell a story that I remember from my very, very early days. So I told them that when I was 4 years old, it was a season I loved watermelon, and it was a season where watermelon was non-existent at the time. But I demanded that my mother will bring me a watermelon, and she said, oh, sorry, but you know, we don't have a watermelon. So I looked at the nearest object that was close to me, that was an old vase that my father received as a gift from Moshe Dayan. Moshe Dayan used to be the Minister of Defense and an archaeology collector. And he brought us one day a very nice ancient vase. And I took it in my hands and I said, if I don't get the watermelon, can you imagine what happened? So I smashed it. That was on Friday. On Saturday, Moshe Dayan came to our house. And together with my father, they sat in the study for about 8 hours. They glued every piece, every broken piece, until the vase became complete again. So that's the earliest story I remember.
Did he ever speak to you again, Moshe Dayan?
Well, he took it gracefully, I think. He didn't like the fact that I broke it. But at the end of the day, since they managed to put everything together, I think he enjoyed it.
Yeah. Okay. After school, you joined Air Force for the most prestigious fighter pilots course. For some personal reasons, you left and returned to this course three times. Before actually completing it. This is very, very rare. Why did you do that? Why did you come back?
So yeah, it was twice. So the first time was actually when my medical profile was dropped after a year. When I was a kid, I suffered from asthma. And usually when you go to the flight course every year, you go through medical exams. Very comprehensive medical exams, and my lungs were not functioning well. So I had to go through a medical committee which adjusted my medical profile from 97, which is the highest, to 45, which is very, very low, which meant that I will not be able to serve in military service in any fighting or combat unit. Which I protested against. I thought that they were too severe with me. And after a short battle, I managed to lift it up a little bit to 76, which was sufficient to go to one of the fighting units, not the Air Force, unfortunately, where I spent about a year. After a year, I claimed that I would like to go back to the flight school. At the end of the day, agreed to accept me, but with limitations. I cannot fly in high altitudes, so helicopters was good enough.
Yeah.
The second time was after I got back, and I spent like 8 months. I got very close to the end of the course, and also very close to the end of my military service. And I wasn't sure that that's what I want to do in life. So my commanders noticed that I'm not 100% complete with the decision to continue, and actually they gave me an opportunity to think about it over. They gave me a letter that within the next 6 months, if I want to come back, I'm welcome. So I took a break and I got back and finished the course.
You took how long was the break? For how long was it?
It was 5 months.
And why did you come back? I mean, you could just go finish the army.
I figured out that after 3 years of military service, I don't want to end up by not doing anything meaningful.
Okay.
And I decided to come back and contribute what I can.
And he did come back. I mean, he served 10 years eventually in the army. And he also received the Israeli military decorations from the Air Force Commander-in-Chief. And there is also a very interesting story about that. So,
yeah, but the evening is short.
Yeah.
In English.
No worry, no worries. So, yeah, we're going to do it short and then last time. But tell us the story about the helicopter and this
event. I'll try to be very brief. Usually when you talk about such events, you don't talk about it with a lot of pleasure. But thank God everything was, at the end of the day, went well. The story in a very short version is that we were training to fly low level at night in the Golan Heights, and my squadron was operating in the north. We took off a pair of Cobra helicopters, and we made a turn over the Lake of Galilee in order to approach the Golan Heights. And my wing member actually decided to fly low level, while we kept high level above the Lake of Galilee. And as they flew low and very fast, relatively to helicopters, they crashed into the water. It was in August of 1986. Mm-hmm. And there was a cold winter time. And we were flying, it was a dark night. We were using at the time night vision goggles. So all of a sudden we saw a spray, white spray around their helicopter as they crashed. We didn't understand what it was. Initially we thought it was smoke and fire. But after a minute, after a few seconds, we figured out probably it's water, a splash of water. And we figured out that they were killed by this crash. Anyway, we decided to go down and land next to them. It was in the water, and we didn't know how high the waters are. So we landed north of them, very close, but north of them, in the water. Thank God the waters were shallow. And we managed to report that our wingman crashed, and we need rescue immediately. And we landed in the water. We shut down the engine, and we ran out. In Cobra, you have two pilots, basically. So me and my partner, we actually went out. We ran to the crashed helicopter. We find it upside down. The two pilots were drowned. They seemed to be dead, trapped in the cockpit. Everything was dismantled. Everything was falling apart. And we managed actually to approach them. And first we did a check to see that they are complete. And then we pulled out, we tried to pull them out in order to get them out of the water.
Yeah.
The problem was that they were trapped. And all we had, all we could is actually pull out their face, only the mask. I mean, we could discover eyes, nose, and mouth. That's it. The two of them. And I don't know the English term, what do you do when you are, probably somebody who did the diving course, no, but we...
Resuscitation. CPR is very easy.
It was the first time I kissed one of my squadron guys. But and we gave them resuscitation, and luckily enough, both of them managed to come back.
Yeah.
And one of my colleagues in my squadron was flying, and he heard everything, so we stayed in order to convey messages, and he actually managed the rescue and actually asked for two rescue units, right, which was good, because we managed to pull out first one of them and then the second one. It was not sure that they will be alive, they will keep alive. But they managed to send them to hospitals, and thank God, after a few weeks of recovery, both of them managed to come back. One of them was, you know, healthy completely. The other one injured a little bit more. He suffered from a brain damage, which the brain compensated after years, and he became a professor. Now he's a professor for physics at MIT. Maybe you need to crash in order to get to...
with an helicopter to the Galileo Sea.
Yeah. The nice story is that I got pneumonia that evening, and just before that, one day I was driving, and an officer stopped me and asked for my license, which was outdated, and then he asked for my insurance, which was outdated, and then the car license, which was outdated, and then they sent me an invitation to court. So in between court and in between this ticket that I got, we had this accident. So when I came to court, I was dressed up as a pilot, but I could barely speak because I had pneumonia. And the judge asked me, what can you say about the fact that you didn't have anything? And I could barely speak. So she said, it was a judge, a lady. She said, I see that you are overly excited. You cannot speak. I understand it, etc. So they took my license for 6 months, but they didn't know that if they take your civil license, you can still keep your military license. So I continue to drive on a on a military car.
That's a good story. I didn't hear this one.
I kept it for you.
Yeah, right. After military service, almost at the age of 28, you went to study engineering for 4 years During this time, you worked in 3-4 jobs in parallel. One of them was as a consultant for the Israeli Air Force industry. During the Lavi project, the huge Lavi project at this time. The termination of this project, which was led by your father, greatly influenced your career decisions from that point on. Why is that?
Yeah, so the Lavi fighter project was a very prestigious project of the Israeli aerospace industries. Israel was actually designing a new fighter plane, and myself with another guy from my squadron, we became consultants to the Israeli aerospace industries and started to work in this project for about 2 years. My father was leading the campaign against this project because the idea was it was too ambitious for a small country. The idea was that maybe we should focus on the avionics, on the electronics, on the software, and not try to build something that the Americans are building anyway. Not try to create a different engine or wings, doesn't make sense. The end of the day, the project was stopped. And when I was walking in the streets or the areas in the Israeli aerospace industries, I was like a red flag there. And when the project was stopped, all the consultants were actually let go, were fired. And I was on the top of the list. I was the first one to be kicked off, and it was a very sad event because I was sitting in an office and my boss was actually sitting in the office. He had a pile of letters of resignation, and even though it was clear everybody knew what they are coming for, it was clear to everyone, still he was so emotionally driven and he was just sitting and crying and couldn't speak. And he handed over the letter and he said, I know that you did a great job for the Israeli aerospace industries, et cetera, et cetera. But I can tell you my own experience from that time was nobody is going to fire me again, because when people are fired, only those who have been fired, and I hope that we don't have a lot of people here, this is very humiliating. Even if you know that you've been great and you did a great job and there was no good reason really to let you go, it was just a force. It was forced on the Israeli aerospace industries. Still, it's very humiliating. So all of you who have employees, please remember it. But my decision was that nobody is going to fire me ever again.
That's a good tweet, guys. actually, in 2005, I had the same. I was fired as well. And I went to take care for my newborn first child for 3 months. My wife got back to work and then I opened my first company. So it's a very small one, but still that was the point. So before we are moving to the next stage, next phase, speaking about Pitango and asking some more interesting questions, could you please share with us three things about you that people don't know?
That people don't know.
Yeah.
Three things.
Yeah, you can start with one.
Sharon, you have any idea?
Yeah, the instruments you play.
Okay. Well, I play music. I play the piano and I play guitar, but it's no good reason for anybody to know that.
but you're still training, right? I mean, you're still...
It comes and goes. Okay. Today, I'm in a time where I'm playing. When I come home, I play a little bit on the piano, then the guitar.
Yeah.
And all my kids are shouting and running away from home. So that's one thing. Second thing that people don't know about me.
I went to your office and I saw some stuff on the wall.
I'm also painting a little bit, usually on iPad and iPhone. Yes, I have some great works of art. As a matter of fact, some people from the industry asked me to have illustrations, so yeah. I printed up for them.
No, really? You really do it on an iPad?
Yeah.
How?
You have great software that allows you to paint with your finger, so... Okay. That's what I'm...
What's the name of the software? You remember?
Brushes. brushes. I'm painting with brushes, even though you have much more advanced generations, I'm stuck with brushes.
Brushes. Good yeah. for brushes.
So that's another thing. A third one.
We leave the third one for the last question.
For the next time.
So let's take 60 seconds of yes, no questions. Now, yes, no questions are very fast, very nice questions, fun, a lot of fun. And I'm going to give you two or three questions of yes, no for the crowd. So you can prepare something
just
as well.
Just for the record and just FYI, so you remember rights of reserved rights. My father invented the terms yes and no. So you might be surprised.
That's great.
Well, don't use it.
Team or single entrepreneur?
Team.
Business plan, yes or no?
You mean team, and you mean team in when I invest or when I start?
When you invest. When you invest. Would you look for a team or in a single entrepreneur?
Well, at the end of the day, there's one that outstands. So it might be a team, but there's always a single person.
Okay. Business plan, yes or no?
Yes, but don't take it as a Bible.
Okay. Crowdfunding, yes or no?
I think yes. I think okay. yes.
Interesting.
I thought no, but over the years, I think it's inevitable. I think the young generation is now, my philosophy, it's not a philosophy, it's my observation, is that the young generation used to choose, when I was younger, used to choose between a study in a university or working in an incumbent company. Today, the young generation has a third option, which is to start a company. So all the things that we know, accelerators, incubators, crowdfunding, Kickstarter, all those tools are meant to build these, to pave this third row. So crowdfunding is helping. They'll be blessed.
Co-working spaces, yes or no?
We are doing, I think we are innovating in a different way. We used to innovate in garage operations. Now we are collaborating in shared workspaces. I like to call it shared innovation space and not co-working space.
Okay. Exit fast or grow your company?
Grow your company if you earn the right to grow your company. Exit fast if you don't. Yes and no.
Yes and no. Exactly.
I prefer growing a business. I prefer building a business long term. I like the culture. I like the opportunity. I don't like the time it takes.
Yeah.
But it's getting shorter and shorter. But I always prefer long term than short term.
Prototype versus user validation.
User validation always.
China versus US.
Both.
Both. Go to market. Start locally or go globally from point one?
It depends on the industry. If you can start locally, start locally. If you can't, don't bother.
Okay. iOS or Android?
Yes. I think both are bringing blessing to the world and curse at the same time. Since we are representing Apple in Israel and we have iDigital, I have to say iOS. But I like both.
Vanilla or chocolate?
Vanilla by far. How many hazelnut even better.
How many vanilla here? It's always half. Oh, and chocolate?
Women prefer chocolate. Wow. If you go to a restaurant and there is a lady waiter and you'll ask her what's their favorite dessert, always it will be chocolate.
Right. Also my wife. So.
Yeah, it's easy.
I don't bother to ask. Museum or a rock concert?
What?
Museum or a rock concert?
Both, I think. Both have great... Everything that has to do with creation and creativity, I'm in favor.
And last one is Ra'anana or Tel Aviv?
The road to Tel Aviv.
Any work in it?
Ra'anana, both are home for me. I mean, I grew up in Tel Aviv. I live now in Ra'anana. I love both places very differently, but I love both places.
Okay, thank you. Now, if you have great, very short questions, raise your hand. Yes. Men or women entrepreneurs?
You know, I don't, honestly, I don't really care if it's a man or a woman. I don't, but maybe I'm very strange. All my life, I never looked at people not according to gender or their or any other aspect. I just purely look at the personality. I look at the vision. I look at the idea, and I don't care if it's a woman or a man. Unfortunately, we have too few women entrepreneurs. This is something that needs to be changed.
Last one. It's a guy from Spain.
Yeah. Prepare to die. You killed my father, prepare to die.
Not yet.
That's my favorite movie.
Right.
One of my favorite. My father killed you, no? Prepare to fight. Yeah. I agree.
I was going to ask, you know, dead or alive, but I'll change my question.
Nutella.
regarding an entrepreneur, energy or vision? Can I pick the question?
I'm not
energy,
sure.
Energy, he said, regarding entrepreneurship, what do I prefer, energy or vision?
Yeah.
Well, you know, you have to have both. I mean, for me, an entrepreneur needs to have a vision. Without a vision, there is no way, and you need to have the energy to, because I believe in persistency. One of the most important things about entrepreneurship is your ability to be persistent, to follow through, because there's going to be bad times, there are going to be ups and downs, and you have to sometimes reinvent yourself. So I think that if you lack the vision, if you lack the energy, you will not be able to succeed. So for me, the human factor is 99% of the idea. I've always judged companies first by the leadership, and energy needs to be there. If you don't have the energy, then enough.
Thank you.
Sorry? Alive? Alive. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Pitango. Pitango was founded in 1993 and is the largest Israeli VC firm, managing more than $1.6 billion. The firm has invested in more than 180 companies with 48 exits. This is all from the website.
Sharon.
Okay.
Well, Pitango was founded as Pitango in 1996. In 1993, myself and my co-founder, we started different funds and we got together in 96. We managed more than $2 billion. We invested in more than 220 companies.
Wow.
We had more than 85 exits. I mean, how many? 85 IPOs or M&As.
So the next question actually came from a few of the people in this room. And are you still investing in seed stage companies?
Sure, we always did, we always will, and we are. But over the years, maybe I'll share with you some observations about seed investments. So we always focused on Israeli entrepreneurs or Israeli technology, and we were diversified by any other thing, meaning that we invested in different technology sectors, different stages, different amounts of money, but we always focused on the Israeli innovation. Last year, we decided actually to change our strategy a little bit because of the tremendous growth of early stage, of seed stage companies, and also because of the tremendous investment in growth that we started to see, delaying the IPO phenomenon. We decided that Pitango is going to create two pockets, one for early stage companies, the other for growth. When we are looking at early stage companies, we really are looking for underlying technologies, or we are looking for second-time entrepreneurs. In our last fund, probably 30% of our investments were in repeat entrepreneurs, people that we backed in the past. We will less invest in ideas that do not have validation in the market.
Right.
we would prefer to wait and see, especially in a very competitive environment when you have 300 companies doing cybersecurity for drones. There's no way you can figure out who is going to be the leader of this market, and we would like to invest in category leaders. So if it's a very competitive landscape, we don't want to invest. We will try to find things that outstand if we want to do something in an early stage. So if we hear another, you know, 20 people pitching the same story, we would say we will be on the bench and we will wait to see how things are moving. If, of course, this is somebody that we know very well, we trust, we know that he or she has the ability to run very fast and has the vision, the energy and everything, we would take the risk and invest in seed stage. Or if we meet outstanding entrepreneurs. Let me give you examples. From Pitango Fund 6, we did 16 seed stage companies, even before there was anything set up. So we invested like angel investors. One of them...
You invest usually 250K?
Usually 250, but it changes. It can be lower, it can be higher. But it's really the first money that clearly is not sufficient. And the notion was that maybe one or two or three will make it funded by us in a round A. Two companies were acquired very, very quickly, relatively speaking. One of them is famous recently, Kira Radinsky with SalesPredict. When we met with Kira, we figured out she's an outstanding person and the vision and the energy were all there. So it was quite immediately a decision to support the company.
Yeah.
The other one was a serial entrepreneur who did his third company, which was acquired by Google very, very fast. But Pitango has always been investing in seed stage companies. What we decided now to do is the whole area of seed is changing. You need to understand, because we meet every day lots of people that are coming with a seed stage. Unfortunately, as a fund, we don't do more than 20, 25 investments per fund. So obviously, we have to say no most of the time. And it's very tough, especially when you see things that are very exciting. But what we decided to do is, since we are doing a fund for growth, a fund for venture, we decided also to start and create incubators. So we created actually two incubators. One of them is publicly known, which is MindUp, which is everything around digital health. And we chose to do it with IBM, which is the largest IT company in the healthcare space, and Medtronic, which is the largest medical device company, and the Rambam Hospital. And together with us, and we're actually investing in everything in very, very early stage, things that we believe have an interesting potential. And we give them the runway to prove that they are viable for round A. So that's one thing that we did.
MindUp, this is the name, MindUp?
MindUp. The second one is something that we are cooking these days. It's an incubator that we are working on right now, and it's a combination of Pitango and a leading university, together with a very interesting group of strategic investors that have also a special theme, and we think that it will serve most of our IT-related early-stage investments. And we think that by doing that, we are doing a better service for the seed stage companies.
So this will be B2B companies?
It will be B2B, it will be B2C. Usually, when you're doing something which is B2C, but you only have an idea, but you cannot validate it, especially if you have other people doing the same stuff, it's like gambling.
Right.
We don't like, just we are ready to take a risk, we're not ready to gamble. So if it's a B2C early stage with no underlying technology, with nothing special about it, besides the belief of the entrepreneur that he's creating something great, we prefer to wait.
Okay.
If it's B2B and has underlying technology, we would definitely move forward. you know, machine learning, deep learning, IT infrastructure, things like that.
Yeah, so this is exactly the next question. What kind of technologies are you looking at? So you just said machine learning and IoT, right? And big data, you told me before. You spoke about mobility, I think.
Yeah,
transportation.
So absolutely. So I think that the coming technologies that are going to change the world are augmented reality and virtual reality, and it requires a whole different set of infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So we would like to invest in this. That includes cybersecurity. It includes, of course, machine learning and deep learning, everything that relates to big data, data analytics, storage, the regular stuff, but it's going to be, the networks are going to be consumed like they never have been consumed before. It's not video, it's way more complicated. So we definitely want to deal with that. Digital health, we believe there's a big revolution around healthcare. Of course, we're looking at unmanned or unpersoned machines, everything from drones to robots, autonomous, whatever it is, that you need to take care of them. Definitely an area of interest for us. Mm-hmm. And everything that relates to data sciences.
Okay, Forescout is one of your portfolio companies, is estimated to be worth over $1 billion. Do you have more unicorns in your portfolio today that you can speak about?
Well, you know, unicorns are companies that have raised money at a valuation of more than $1 billion.
Right.
Unicorn is a phenomena which I'm not really interested in. I'm looking more at the business, and what I'm more interested is to see more Israeli companies that can sell $1 billion a year. I think this is the target. This is what we should look at. And it doesn't, it's not called unicorn, but those are significant companies. I think, you know, today we have a number of companies in our portfolio that the revenues are hundreds of millions of dollars, and I can see clearly how they cross the $1 billion in revenues, and I'm looking forward for these companies to go public. And we have companies which have the potential to get there. Mm-hmm. So I'm very interested in those.
One of them will be VIA?
I believe so.
Yeah. Can you share the story about VIA? What do they do? And how you came to invest in VIA?
So I invested in VIA before I met them.
Okay.
Because I heard what they do, and I just thought that the idea was brilliant. And then I met the founders, and then I knew that I want to invest. Unfortunately, I got to them right after they raised round A, but I told them, please call me when you're thinking about your next round. Of course, they didn't call me, but I called them. And we led the round B. So first of all, these are really fantastic entrepreneurs. Both of them are top elite unit graduates. Both of them did their PhDs. One did it in the Weizmann Institute, the other at Stanford University. And what they did is actually one of them lived in the US and one in Israel. The one who lived in the US had a problem to get from home to work every day because he lived far away from the bus station or from the subway. He couldn't afford a taxi. So he had to use public transportation, which was lousy. And what's the problem with public transportation? The problem is that the lines are fixed, the schedule is fixed, and the stations are fixed. Now, as a user, you have to adjust yourself to the public transportation instead of the public transportation works for you. By the way, this reverse we're going to see in many, many areas in our life. So he spoke with his friend, and his friend said, why don't we do moniot shirut, you know, taxi service, like in Tel Aviv, you know, that they pick up. But
like shared taxis.
Sorry?
Shared taxis.
Shirut.
Oh, shirut.
Shirut, service.
Okay. Service.
In Tel Aviv, for those of you who don't live in Israel, there are taxi services. It's a shared ride. You know, people are, but it's very much like buses. It's So the idea was, let's leverage big data, let's leverage algorithms, and let's revolutionize the public transportation so the public transportation will pick me up from home. But it will not pick me from my doorstep. It will pick me from a corner near my house, and it will drop me in a corner next to my office. Mm-hmm. When I want to go back, again, from corner to corner, I will have an app just like Uber, right? But I don't book a car. I book a seat. It's a completely different story. And like public transportation, the price is fixed. It doesn't matter if it's rush hour or not.
Okay.
And I loved it. And then what I understood they did is after they developed it for 2 years and they launched the service in New York quietly, they're using luxurious cars, SUVs. So you really sit in chairs like this, you know, leather chairs. It's air conditioned. And it's just great. It's like a bus. It's a small bus. It costs only $5 to go from anywhere in New York. And the good thing about it is that it is a service that commuters in a city are using twice a day. Now, more and more people go to live in cities. And as they go to live in cities, they give up their car. Now they need to commute to work and back. They can do it with bikes or walk or subway or metro or Uber. So VIA is going after the public transportation. It doesn't go after Uber. Uber will continue to service people that have a lot of money. They can order a car. And they can pay $50 sometimes. Uber provides a better service to the public transporters. And they change the life of people.
Right.
That's what I liked about it.
So you have VIA in your portfolio, and you have Taboola on your portfolio, and many very interesting, Forescout, and many interesting. What's your...
Forescout is my partner, Rami. And not
oh, Rami.
Not, not
well,
my
it's still,
still a
part
Pitango
of Pitango,
portfolio.
Right? Yeah. So what's your secret sauce?
We don't have a secret. I think what we have done is we worked very hard for 24 years. We've seen a lot of companies. We decided to create a large partnership, so it's not a one-man show. We adjusted our values, which are to build successful economics based on the Israeli brain power. And we've learned from what we've done. We constantly looked at what we did wrong, what we did well. And we try to do better than worse, to learn from our mistakes. And I think today we raise the bar. And we are looking really for the best ideas that are out there.
Are you in personally involved in any investment? Like you have to approve every investment? You or your partner?
So each partner works on his or her different different companies.
Yeah.
They do the, usually we do the due diligence in a small group of people, and then we pitch it to the partnership. And in the partnership and the team, everybody gets to see the company. Mm-hmm. Everybody gets to say what he or she has to say.
Yeah.
It's quite open to everyone, and everybody speaks freely. Sometimes people think it's a stupid investment. Sometimes people think it's a great investment. You have to fight for your investment if you believe in it. And sometimes it's it becomes very controversial that there are clashes inside. Some people think it's a mistake to invest in the company. Some people think it's okay. Rarely you have opportunities where everybody says this should be a great investment opportunity. It happens usually in later stages when the business model is already proven. But I'm involved in every investment.
Sound to me like a very interesting meeting to be like fly on the wall.
Sometimes frustrating.
Let's go for more questions from the crowd. For first
from
time
the audience.
From the audience.
Yeah.
Thanks. For the first time entrepreneurs, what will be the best way to reach for a meeting with an associate or partner in Pitango?
Well, there are things that you should avoid from doing,
yep.
Right? If you are sending an email and you say, dear sir, madam, clearly you don't understand what you're doing, because when you're approaching a VC, you are selling. When you sell, you have to sell. So you have to And this is your first test as an entrepreneur. If you don't sell well, nobody is going to buy. Another sentence you should avoid is saying, we're going to be the next Uber. I mean, you don't start an email by saying, we're going to be the next Uber, we're going to do to this what Airbnb did to that, what Uber did to that. It's not serious. If you want to build a company, if you want to do a business, you should really sell it seriously. And you cannot just try to impress people with dropping examples like Uber and Airbnb. There are not a lot of Airbnb, there are not a lot of Ubers in the world. Okay, and it's not easy to imitate. It's even superficial to say that you're going to be an Uber. So the best way to approach a VC is through a trusted partner, somebody who knows a person who could bring you and get the attention.
Mm-hmm. Find a trusted partner. That's the
don't
first
do thing. Don't do cold calls, definitely not dear sir, madam. It's just delete immediately in all the funds that I know. It's sorry? You should start your email by saying, dear Chemi.
I met you last night.
I met you last night at the startup grind. No, but you should really seriously, you should be able to write an introductory email that is serious, that is respectful. Describe your idea in a very short manner. But I'm saying again, the best way to approach a VC, and it's not, look, we are just overwhelmed with ideas. Lots of people are coming to us. We try to respect everyone. We try to get back to everyone. And you should, at the end of the day, you need, it's like in life, you need to outstand in order to be observed. If you can't do that, mm-hmm. then, and it's a natural selection because as an investor, we want to invest in people that can conquer their customers, if you understand what I'm saying. It's basically, I'm a customer, you have to sell to me, right? So use all your skills, use your connections, and get in front of us, hopefully through somebody that we know. That's the best way to get, if I'm getting a call from one of the lawyers that work with us, or an accountant that work with us, or an entrepreneur that we invested in, or somebody else. And he tells us, look, I've seen a company, and I think it's a very interesting company that you need to meet. We drop everything and we meet.
Right.
But if you send a confused message, or an unprofessional approach, or insufficient material to demonstrate what you do, it's not serious. And if it's not serious, you don't get the attention of serious investors. I'm not talking about Pitango, I'm talking about general.
That's a very good tip, I think. Ran, did he answer your question? Yep. So, hi, Chemi.
Hi.
Met you last night. What?
Women don't want to be called madam.
Nobody wants to be called sir or madam with a slash. I mean, it's disrespectful. I mean, it's like you're, or sometimes people are sending emails when my name appears in blue and the message is in black. It means that you probably send that email to 100,000 people. So, I mean, why bother? We don't want to be in the mass audience or mass business. We're in a very unique business which has to do with trust, with relationship. We're going to put a lot of money. We're going to sit on your board. We're going to spend the next 10 years with you, going through ups and downs. You have to start the relationship different. If I want to marry somebody, I wouldn't send her an email that says, dear madam. No. I happen to be in town if you are free. Doesn't work like this.
I met you last night.
Anyway.
Yes, let's take some more.
You're a man of experience and worked a lot of money in startups.
Yeah, that's a very, very interesting. The question was giving my experience in investing and working with companies. What is my experience working with Israeli Arabs? So Pitango basically believes that innovation is changing the world. And basically we like to look at the world in three circles around the axis of innovation. The first one is what we do as Pitango, meaning that we try to invest in significant companies, in great entrepreneurs doing great stuff. We know that most of the cases you don't succeed, but from time to time you have successful companies. And we need to stay in the forefront and continue to upgrade the quality of the investment, the quality of the work that we do with those startups, and build them for the long run. So that's one circle which is simple. Long ago, we understood that in order to be a startup nation, as we want to be, there are parts in our society which are not taking part in the circle of innovation. And namely, there are two major parts of our society. One is the Arab society or Arab community and or non-Jewish community or the minorities community. The other one is the ultra-Orthodox. And we started to work with both sectors. And we launched our first fund. That was actually the first fund to invest in the Israeli non-Jewish minority. Initially, it was a public-private partnership. The government had a tender. We won the tender because we managed to raise money to match the government funding. The government invested, committed to invest $20 million. We raised $30 million, so we had $50 million. And we were going after companies in the Israeli Arab community. The idea was, if they operate locally, let's integrate them into the ecosystem of Israel. If they're operating in Israel, let's try to go for the region. If they're in the region, let's go to the Muslim world. If they're already there, let's go to the world. And if we see something that is outstanding in terms of innovation, we'll go directly to the world. Initially, we thought the intention was to invest in mature companies that have been growing by themselves, but we failed to invest. We failed to invest in companies like that, even though we have screened many. And there are many reasons why we did not manage to make such investments. Part of it is that it's family-owned businesses that are used to operate in a certain way, not really open in many cases to get a private equity investment. But very quickly, we figured out that there is a young generation in the Arab world which is outstanding. And imagine, like every society, you have a group of people which are really outstanding. And we said, let's find these outstanding people and let's invest in them. And we said, basically, as we analyzed the opportunity, we figured out that just like the Chinese has created their own market, the Chinese-speaking internet market is different from the English-speaking internet market. We thought, here is an opportunity in the Middle East. You have 22 countries, 350 million people. Let's look at it as a market, the Arabic-speaking internet market, and let's see if we can build companies to address that market. Because the fund is small, and you don't have a lot of experience in management, and you don't have other co-investors to support you. You're by yourself. So we build every investor with a very long runway. When we started, it was like really not only seeding the companies, but really working with them hand in hand. But it was amazing to see that after a year, after 18 months, those entrepreneurs were just outstanding entrepreneurs. If they pitch, they pitch as good as any other Israeli startup company that we have been investing in. Really great, great entrepreneurs. So I think it's very challenging. Again, as I said, lack of experience, lack of management experience, lack of other funding resources. You need to operate on a regional basis. It's not simple. But I can tell you that the quality is amazing. And those guys could have been, you know, the best developers in 8200 in any other, but they don't go, most of them, to military service. But they go to great universities, they're highly skilled, they're highly motivated, they want to be integrated into the world. And it's a complete different generation than the previous generation.
So let me interrupt. So the first fund was Al Bawadir, right?
Yes.
And then you had another one called Emilia? It's and Tuckwin Labs, right?
Yes.
So you have different kind of funds for different kind of stages.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the idea of Al Bawadir was really about inclusivity, about investing in our own backyard. Amelia was something that I did in my capacity as the chairman of the Paris Center for Peace. I decided to create also for-profit platforms that can feed the non-for-profit platform. And I created the Amelia, which is a fund which is investing in Israeli companies which are doing business in the region. They don't have to build their future on the business on the region, but they have to be proactively operating in the region. Oops. Sorry. I hope it's not me. And basically we raised Amelia as a fund and started to invest. And actually the first investment we did was to create Tuckwin Labs. Tuckwin in Arabic means creation. And the idea was to invest seed money in Arab entrepreneurs. We did 6 investments so far from Tuckwin. We raised $12 million. By the way, most of the money comes from Israeli Arabs and Palestinians. And and at some point in time, I spoke with Imad Talhami, a good friend, and he wanted to join the incubator, so we brought him, and then we brought JVP as well. They wanted also to be part of it. So we actually created an incubator that is owned by Amelia, JVP, and Imad. We took Itzik Fried to run the incubator, who is doing an amazing job. And I can see that following the Al Bawadir generation, the new entrepreneurs are no less better than those. So it's a very interesting experience. I think it's a beginning, but I'm very much confident that with a little bit of effort and investment and collaboration, the Arab entrepreneurs will demonstrate and will experience soon successes.
Very short follow-up question. Do you see that also collaboration between versus like two separate entities? Like one society?
No, collaborate. That was one of the rules that we adopted in the beginning. We said we're not investing in China. We're investing in our home backyard. So it is crucial to have Jews and Arabs work together. And in all our companies, we have Jews and Arabs working together in these companies.
Let's take 2 more. Yeah.
Of course, the first thing that we do is, of course, we invest. And then we join the board of directors, and we try to balance between interfering and micromanaging. We don't like to do micromanagement. But I think one of the things that I've learned as an investor when I invest and I work with the founders is that I try to offer them everything that I can help. And it's really for them to choose and pick. Some of them, there's been CEOs where I met with every week, and they just told me about their thoughts, their fears, their hopes, their ideas. It's like coaching. In some cases, we help them get in front of customers and strategic partners, and we have done that a lot. Sometimes it changes the face of the company when you manage to do that. Sometimes we help them grow the company in terms of building their management infrastructure, and we have recruitment capabilities for C-level. So it's really being an entrepreneur in a startup company is one of the toughest things in the world because you are by yourself, you are surrounded with enemies, and nobody listens to you. And at the end of the day, you need to make the company work, sometimes against all odds. VCs usually can add value in financing, in recruitment, and in strategic decisions. But at the end of the day, it's really in the hands of the entrepreneur. So even if I work in a company, let's say you mentioned Taboola, so Adam Singolda is a great entrepreneur. He has to work very, very hard, compete, and grow the company, and recruit, and solve all the problems in the company. So he works very, very hard, and it's a very demanding position. So I try to complement as much as I can. I try not to take too much time and bother unnecessarily sometimes. Some of the VCs would like to add value. They add so much value that they just kill the company by adding too much value. So you have to find the balance, and you have to find where your work is really adding value and when you're starting to be really pain in the ass. Excuse my...
Yeah.
If I can share a failure, we need to choose from lots of failures. When I'm asked about this question, you know, most of the failures are either we were too early, we invested way ahead when the market was not ready, so timing was very, very tough. In some cases, we misjudged the quality of the entrepreneurs and they turned to be not as great as we thought. And in other cases, we misjudged the market. We didn't understand that the market is actually not going to be there for us. I can tell you one story, which is, I think it's a success story and also a failure. Ken Velo. I think it's a very interesting story. It was one of my first investment was in a company called VocalTec. And VocalTec was doing voice over IP for the first time. It was our first internet company. When we invested in the company, the business model was not so clear. They developed sort of a plug, hardware plug that you put into the computer and it allows you to speak on networks, computer networks. We didn't call it voice over IP. We didn't know it's voice over IP at the beginning. But the entrepreneur was a visionary, lots of energy. But the business model was not there. So we reached a point where we ran out of money. We had like a burn rate of, if I recall right, about $150,000 a month. Income was about $30,000 a month. Clearly the direction was there. And he demonstrated the leadership because what he did is initially went to the bank and provided his own personal guarantees for the continuation of the company. And then he approached us and asked us to do the same, which we did. And then he said, I'm going to the US. I'm going to come back only with a deal. Give me 2 months. I'm not going to let the company die, which gave us a lot of confidence. And he came up back with two deals. We choose one deal at the end of the day. And from a crashing pattern, 6 months later, we were going for a public offering in NASDAQ, which was really a crazy pattern when you think about it, from a complete disaster to a great success. But I think at the end of the day, we didn't manage to draw the entire potential that was in the company. So I think if you look at the failure side, I think we failed to build a big company based on voice over IP. Skype, actually, the story after we did VocalTec, the founder of VocalTec created another company called ITXE, which we invested in, which was very successful. It was a carrier for voice over IP. The idea was that they will buy the equipment from VocalTec. We took it public also in NASDAQ. And then he came up with another project, which was called Truly Global. Truly Global was Skype. That was the business plan of Skype a few years before. And he said, I won't start without $10 million. We told him, you have five from us, find another $5 million from another fund, which never happened. And then Skype came out. So I think it was a combination of, and I think life is, it's always a combination of failure and success. They're very, very close. Some companies are successful just because they were lucky and they could have been a failure. And some companies fail while they could have been successful if we did some things differently. So I'm trying to learn at the end of the day from what works, not from what doesn't work. I don't think you can learn a lot from what doesn't work. But you need to look at the things that work and try to understand why they work. If you figure out why they work, you make less mistakes. If you don't find them, don't invest.
So actually, I have two more questions in this stage, and then we have like the last one, but I'm going to skip my questions because I see so many people want to ask theirs. So we take one from behind. Yes, you guy.
Well, it's what you are describing was referring to a question about the chief scientist office role. And what I said is that what I like about the chief scientist office in Israel is that their money is dedicated to technology and innovation. Because most people, when they invest in a company, they see the R&D as an expense. They don't see that as an investment. Somehow you want to have the product without investing in it and really focus your efforts on marketing and sales. What I said is that we would like, as investors, we would like that our investment will be driven by the business side, less by the research side. So I think in Israel, what is unique about the chief scientist is that the chief scientist is providing the funding as long as you are putting it into R&D. And this is why we keep innovating. And this is why I think that the investment of the chief scientist is so crucial and so important. And this is why I think we should have the chief scientist strengthened with bigger budgets and let the investors really focus on building the business around it. Well, when yeah, so you know, long ago I was one of the founders of the Israeli Venture Association, which is now IATI, the Israel Advanced Technology Industries, and I was the second chairman. The first one was the head of Yozma, because he came from the government and everybody agreed. But when he left, I became the chairman. And actually, as a chairman, I did two major things. One is, and I don't like to talk about me, so I'll say the IVA, the Israel Venture Association, did two things. One was we managed to convince the Minister of Finance at the time to give tax ruling for foreign investors that are investing in technology and innovation in Israel, which works until today, which is great, because that allowed all those funding to come from abroad. And the second one is we discussed the R&D law, and we told the government that the R&D law is frightening all the investors. They don't want to touch a company which got funded by the chief scientist office, because if you sell the IP, if you take it out, it's like against the law. So they said, what do you want from us? I said, what I want is, first of all, to allow the IP to go out, because what is important for Israel is to be able to create new IP, not necessarily to protect old IP, because things are moving forward. Let's make sure that we are like a fountain. We have more and more water coming out as opposed to trying to hold them. Then try to figure out if you buy, if you sell your company and the IP goes out, first of all, it's not against the law. And secondly, what you pay is going to be certain, final, and very clear. So that triggered the change of the R&D law, which was concluded later on. And basically, today, it's very simple. So some people still carry the notion that if the chief scientist invested in you, it's bad. As an investor, I can tell you it's good, because first of all, the chief scientist examined the company, and they have some very good referees that are doing a good job. So what you have is viable. And secondly, the funding of the chief scientist, relatively to the funding that the company is going to get through the years, is insignificant. Now, if you sell the company, you can first of all take out the IP. It's no longer against the law, so Microsoft can buy companies. And secondly, the penalty, quote unquote, that you get is final, and it's very simple. There is a very simple formula. So it's a misperception that continues from those days. But today, the law is fine.
Okay. Avi, I want to ask you to take a question now, because you've been with us from the first event. And yes, go ahead. This is my last question, Avi.
If you want to change your life, well, the first advice I would say, don't go to work. Stay home and think about it, and think why you want to change your life. At the end of the day, very few people are daring to change their life. Usually they do it after a significant event. I mean, either, you know, sometimes it's a company exit, sometimes you leave your job. I don't want to change my life. I think it's good.
My last question is, and the last question of every event, is the Peter Pan question, which is what you, Chemi, Nehemiah, Jacob, Peres, would like to do when you grow up.
I don't want to grow up.
The Peter Pan question.
Last year when I had my birthday, a friend wrote me, sent me SMS, and he said, don't give up youth. Well, we are all, I'm saying that we are all staying on the same conveyor, which is moving in one direction. I have no illusions about it. I know that our time is timed at the end of the day, and all of us are moving in one direction. Some of us are ahead of the conveyor, some of us are a little bit back, some people are falling, unfortunately, on the way. But you know, I'm sure that at one point in time, the issue of longevity will be solved. Initially, it will be extended. And then I'm a great believer that human being will crack the idea. I don't know what will happen that time. I don't know if I'm going to be part of it. But what I do for myself, since I'm an optimist, I accelerate my optimism a little bit. And I'm saying that I believe that in my time or in our time, we'll find a solution. We'll transition it as Yuval Noah Harari wrote in his new book, The History of Yesterday, that we would transition death from biology, from the biological field into the engineering field, meaning that we'll make it a solvable problem that will be only engineering. I believe it will happen. I'm not sure that I will be alive to live those days, but I hope and I believe that maybe there is a chance. So I keep optimism, and I hope that I will live forever. Who knows?
I want to guess. So few months ago, Izar Shai was here, and we spoke. And last question, I asked him the same question. And then I said it. I asked him, what about politics? And he said whatever he said. Now, I'm not going to ask you about politics, but there is something that I think is something you would like to do when you grow up. Someone told me you are really into architecture, an architect.
Well, architecture has been the love of my life. As when I went to high school, I went to Ort Technicum at the time, and my plans were to become an architect. My military service changed everything, and I ended up by studying engineering. But I learned over the years that it's not really about architecture, it's about your ability to be involved in creation, in creating new things. The thing that I love most is to start new things, is to build new things, to create value, not necessarily financial value, but value. And I find myself involved in many, many different projects where I think they are contributing and I'd like to be part of it. So, and architecture is just a reincarnation of the notion that what I want to do is really continue and create. So if I can create many, many years, many things, I'll be very, very happy and very blessed. And I think that at the end of the day, what you leave, when you leave the world, what you leave is your deeds, what the things that you've done in your life, not necessarily what you thought that you said or were hoping, but more the things that you actually did.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.